probably out Peke Peke.
Well,
apart from a backdoor at the end of the game.
Peke would require some backdoor
action
there, and I wasn't having
it. It was a Peke-esque performance then here, as we're going to look for a last ban now for Fnatic. Wonder what it will be. They've got a lot of choices here. And this is the thing, when you're on the blue side, it's great to get first pick, but you potentially give over two strong champions. And respect to Meteos, Kobe. Goodbye.
They don't want to have any more of that DPS Vi build. Soaz really felt that one. It was such a well-timed ultimate from Meteos as well to hold him in place for the sneaky ultimate on Draven. But it is the other top lane ban here. You ban the Mundo, ban the Shyvana, since Fnatic does have first pick. And we'll have to see what direction they want to go with this time. Is it going to be, again, early game oriented? Or are they actually going to go the more late game route?
We'll have to see. And it was kind of funny with the last game. We mentioned that Fnatic's team looked quite early game oriented with what they picked. But Cloud9 kind of felt like the early game team running away with that last game. But Fnatic definitely going to know that that's kind of coming now. And probably play a little bit more reserved, a little bit more safely.
So Cloud9 definitely had a handle on the comp that they were running. They knew that they were picking losing lanes, and that's why there was such a huge CS discrepancy early on and why Fnatic had that gold lead. But they made up for it with the roaming and the rotations.
And it's funny because the way Meteos plays kind of facilitates needing lanes to win, but they kind of like, you know what, we can just chill out. Once we hit level 6, it's all going to be okay. And a great performance here in game 1. But here in game 2, Elise is the first pick for Fnatic.
So this is also a really good snag by Fnatic, taking that away from Meteos. They banned out Vi, and they picked one of his old favorite champions, which was Elise. Really loves going back to that champion over and over again.
And Leona's locked in again there for elimination. They're considering Kha'Zix as well, and they do lock that in. So now over back to Fnatic here. What do you think of Kha'Zix, actually, Kobe?
I love playing Kha'Zix. Anytime you have resets and you can continually jump over after getting your kills, then it's a great mechanic. But he also has amazing dueling potential because of the change that happened to his Q. And he now not only has the isolation damage, but also execute damage. So he can finish the people off to more easily get those resets.
And I think you mentioned it yesterday when we saw Kha'Zix. He can kind of play in any of the three roles, really, jungle, top, or mid. So a little versatile in that respect as well. Going back to the drawing board here for Fnatic, Lucian and Renekton, they like these picks again, given the changes that have happened with some of the bans.
Yeah, I mean, last time they picked this duo, I talked about lane bullying early, lane dominance. So again, Fnatic, that along with an Elise, there's a lot of power here for them, pre-10-minute mark.
And looks like Falls has decided to go back
to an
old favorite.
Rumble?
Rumble.
Didn't expect that one.
Draven again for Sneaky as well. I have to say, Sneaky's Draven, of that game 1, probably looked the least impressive, but given how well that game went for Cloud9, that's not really a big thing. So, but seems to like Draven here, likes it against Lucian in particular, you have to think here. So, solid pick so far for Cloud9, but it probably means we're having Kha'Zix up towards the top, mid lane, sorry.
So, we're getting the same duo matchup here. If it is going to be the same 2 versus 2 lane, something's going to have to change for Cloud9, because that was almost unacceptable there. For the Leona Draven, they really did get behind very early, and they're only saved by the collapse of High and the collapse of Meteos up there that was able to turn it around.
Reckless is having a little bit of fun, as you can probably tell, but they're going to lock in with Orianna Thresh as their last few picks, and Instant Fiddle picked for Meteos, actually.
Yeah, he's also been a very... This is another one of the new ones. I talked about Elise being one of his old favorites, Fiddlesticks, one of his new favorites. And, you know, this is before the duration on Fear was taken down a notch. When you have a jungle Fiddlesticks, you always have to be watching out for invades, though. Every single person on Cloud9 is going to have to be paying attention to their own jungle at all times, because early on in the game, if Fiddlesticks gets found by Elise early game, he's going to get destroyed.
Yeah, and I actually like jungle Fiddle a little bit more than maybe support Fiddle, and we have seen it in the support role before, Kobe.
Yeah.
The thing with Fiddle, though, is you need levels. If you want to get that fear to crazy, crazy numbers in terms of how long the duration is, you actually need levels. And getting them as a support can be difficult. With Meteos' farm style as a jungler, he's probably not going to have too much trouble unless he gets invaded, like you point out.
And to not get invaded, you also want to have strong early lanes, which is actually what Fnatic have. So the stage is set here for Fnatic to shove their lanes in and then use this Elise to go wreak havoc all over Meteos' jungle and mess up the early game for him.
I think I like the top lane matchup for balls, though, to be perfectly honest. Yeah. There's a lot of push and pull between Rumble and Renekton, but it's interesting. I think Rumble kind of gets to a point maybe between level 3 and 5, and especially level 6, where he can kind of bully around Renekton depending on what happens. I mean, Cyanide's at least going to be a big factor here in this game.
It's going to be interesting because I think that Cloud9 still might want to look for 2v1 lane swaps because that also sort of upsets the jungle invading balance since your team is pretty much giving up one side of the jungle where your AD and support is and you're going to take your opponent's respective other side. We'll have to see if they actually pull off the switch.
All right, so we are going to get into game two now in the Battle of the Atlantic. It's Fnatic versus Cloud9. Cloud9 up a game here in this best of three. Fnatic looking to answer back here in this one and push it to a third and final game. And I do love your point about lane swaps to kind of protect your jungle a little more, Kobe. And we'll see, we had a swap last time, ended up with four people up towards the top. We'll see how the early lanes in the level one kind of shakes out here.
Yeah, so they're again sending balls initially down to the bottom side. So it looks like Cloud9 are heading for the swap. Leona just barely stepped out of that bush. So they saw Lemon Nation already.
Not a big change in terms of early game items for support. So in fact, they're identical to their starts in game one. So we're not gonna have any extra wards like you pointed out. Some supports do still like to go kind of all consumables with a lot of wards early on to kind of get that early vision, but the trinket system's done really interesting things for vision, especially in the early game.
Something I did point out yesterday, but I still want to say it again just because we're not gonna have any more games on this patch, but the while the trinkets do currently show you know, how many wards you have placed, it's always nice for me to have my support start out with a sweeper so you don't give that information away to the enemy jungler and you're not aware of how many wards are down. That's now been changed on live, but Lemon Nation right here, he know.
Oh, Reckless, that's not where you want to be standing. I think he spots off Leona, realizes, oh, this is a beautiful bait from Cloud.
Tagged.
Lemon Nation gonna bait them in. Reckless is so close.
Okay, so what he just saw right there was the aura from Fiddlesticks. It tipped off Reckless. Whenever you see that on you, you know that Fiddlesticks is around you. When, as soon as that popped up, you can see him freaking out, walks away from the bush. And it's one of the very, very slight drawbacks to Fiddlesticks. Even if they don't have vision of you, you see that on you, and you can be assured that he is near.
And that just saved Reckless's life, I have to think. I love the bait there from Lemon Nation. Oh, yeah, hooky, totally fine. But no, everything's going to kind of calm down here in the early game as Fiddle's going to start blue. To be fair, Cloud9 actually grouping in that bottom bit of brush basically secures the blue early on for Fiddle.
Yeah, that was definitely an exciting start, even though nothing really came of it. Fiddlesticks getting his own blue, you're right, is a huge win for them. Plus, we've got actually a little bit slow of a start for Cyanide over there. So he's going to be making his first gank a little bit later.
The lanes do shake out kind of as we expected here, very standard. We've got Hai versus Pekka in the mid, that's Kha'Zix versus Orianna. Four people down the bottom as the duo lanes take on each other, and it will be Renekton versus Rumble.
So we do get to see that Rumble-Renekton matchup that you're looking for, and we'll see how Ball's fabled Rumble can actually match up against the top lane beast, Renekton, who's known for pretty much bullying every single champion.
I mean, Balls would have played this matchup hundreds, if not thousands of times almost
thousands?
At this
point. Thousands? Come on, that's getting a little excessive.
maybe 1,000
games.
He does
love Rumble, though.
He does love Rumble. Be interesting to see how many games he actually had on it, but he would definitely know this matchup, that's for sure.
That he definitely does know the matchup. Now we're going to have to start worrying about jungle influence because Elise has cleared both buffs and should probably be looking you know, for a gank or for an invade on a Fiddlesticks. Make something happen early game because I feel like it's just really his move to make, you know, before that 10-minute mark.
And Cyanide's someone who's kind of known for a lot of counter-jungle. Actually spotted him as Olaf in the last game, just walking around, kind of checking camps with axes, wanting to try and take some jungle away from Meteos, because he knows that he, as Olaf especially, he can walk in and fight and clear camps quickly. Elise is a great duelist, but doesn't necessarily clear the jungle quickly.
Right, and if they are just going to have a farm off here, that will be Meteos's dream. He would love to just hard farm all the way till level 6 because that point is where Fiddlesticks comes out with the very, very strong ganks using his Crow Storm and being able to get over walls, they could come up with something like a double kill down in bottom where they have a support who's amazing at setting up those jungle ganks, even from the lane.
And I like that you pointed out that kind of the Vi pre-6 gank works once with the flash. I think there's a very similar thing there with Fiddlesticks as well. The flash fear probably gets somebody one time, but maybe not again.
Right, and you're going to have to wait a little bit to level up the fear. It doesn't start out at 3 seconds.
Thankfully, no.
But it still is pretty potent. The first move, though, will be made by Cyanide, trying to visit up top, and he's going to look at balls. We'll see if he can actually land that cocoon. That flash over the minions is why there was no follow-up right there. Really, really well played by Balls.
Yeah, really clever coming out, kind of knowing that he just needed to flash instantly. Didn't hesitate. Flash over the minions, as you said, to avoid the Cocoon Kirby. And that's a nice little bit of play. Look, kind of a trade down the bottom. Leona wants to go in, and Sneaky's not afraid. Elimination aggressive in there as well. And I mean, again, these lanes are going to go very aggro on each other, back and forth all the time here. And Lemon really trying to assert some dominance on Leona.
Yeah, they're trying to get something back here because, once again, they're getting crushed in CS already. This Lucian is really making his early game trading power felt, and Sneaky's just trying to catch back up.
I mean, this is what we felt from Fnatic in all of their lanes here is, ooh, Meteos. Very sneaky here as the Fiddlesticks is going to walk in, try a gank here. Level 1 fear, not too long, but he's going to go in there. Soaz gets feared up. The Dark Wind as well in the minion. That's really, really clever. The Ignite going to go off, but it doesn't quite get the kill.
Best part there for Meteos was that he got the fear off right before Slice and Dice able to touch him. So Soaz didn't get the reset or the second activation on it and had to burn his flash.
I mean, Meteos did kind of everything there to make that gank go off and almost got the kill. Oh, that Cyanide down the bottom. Sneaky's like, I don't really want to be here. Elimination's like, yeah, I don't either. Flay back there. Death Sentence misses, though. And that's probably going to keep Leona alive.
He still has Flash, too.
Has Flash and Ignite.
They didn't even get the Flash out of Lemon there. That was actually very nice from Sneaky and Lemon. I'm assuming that Cyanide missed his cocoon while off-screen there on Sneaky because he didn't have to burn summoners.
There was actually a ward down there as well in that bush for Cloud9. I don't know if that was there when they went when at least came for the initial gank, but if it was, maybe it was a bait there from Cloud9 just to avoid it off and burn a couple of summoner spells.
Regardless, Cloud9, you know, even though they do have the losing lanes and they're down in CS, they've at least avoided the deaths from the early game jungle of Elise, and it's getting towards that time, you know, post level 6 Kha'Zix, where you gotta start worrying about a roaming assassin coming down your lane that was not there before.
Yeah, and that's what we saw a lot from High in the last game on Kassadin, of course, as well. Now, Kassadin, probably a better roamer than Kha'Zix, I'd say, but High can definitely do work here. And it's interesting, again, this game starting in a very similar fashion. All three kind of solo laners or farmers here for Fnatic are ahead on CS once again by quite a significant amount in some situations as well. But Cloud9 staying calm, waiting for Meteos, and if it happens again what happened last game, level 6 is going to be an explosion of ganks.
They really need to convert the gank because they're getting so far behind in CS. They're pretty much down a couple kills already just because of so much money gained from CS leads. They do have kill potential in a couple of their lanes, most notably that mid lane and the bottom lane, you know, because Peke took cleanse since he's facing a Fiddlesticks, which is fairly common, instead of a barrier. Just means that in that gank, he's not going to be able to have that extra health, and he's going to have to use that cleanse on fear.
Now, bottom lane trades are going to get a little awkward here for Cloud9 because the BF cell's already finished up, but Meteos is actually wandering down. I almost feel like
in.
This is a bait. He did get
he
in.
He did get in there.
And Crowstorm going to channel now. So Yellowstar could be in trouble. Flash on top of him, and that's so much damage moving through. He does flash out, though. The damage coming through for Sneaky, and the last hit does give Draven first blood.
So they're able to give it over to Draven and pop his Adoration stacks. That can get him right back in this lane.
And I kind of mentioned it before, Fnatic would have noticed that there was no BF sword there for Sneaky, knowing they could get him for the trade. And Meteos, I think, set that up really nicely, being like, they're going to try and fight you. I'm going to rotate down and then I'm level 6. And they insta-rotate to Dragon as well.
Talked about how happy Meteos would be hard farming to level 6. Cyanide does get caught in his jungle now.
Nice little rappel out there. The Spiders actually dodge the Electro Harpoon. And Fnatic rotating through. Cyanide going in. Orianna also went very nice to catch up balls. And Rubble in trouble. The damage ridiculous, though. And Kha'Zix actually going to get the trade kill.
And because, you know, he's not level 11 yet, doesn't have two upgrades from his ultimate, he does not have the ability to reset. So after he goes in for that kill, he's going to have to flash out.
Yeah, I mean, we talk about level 6 being a nice level. Oh, Lemon Nation can attack Reckless down the bottom. And he's in a little bit of trouble. Death Sentence does land into him. Leona in trouble here. Meteos is down. I don't know if he can make it happen, though. Fear wants a yellow style, Reckless trading back and forth. And a really nice kill down the bottom for Fnatic.
Yeah, that was a very well-played death sentence. You could see Lemon trying to bait him, trying to juke him out, but he did not get the right step there. And even though Meteos is in the area, they can't convert a return kill because there's no damage dealt in that trade.
And unfortunately for Lemon, no ultimate there either on Leona, so couldn't quite make some additional plays that he may have liked to. Pekka and High going to continue their farm off in the lane here. And I was going to say, I'm surprised that High has blue buff, but I guess he just got it from the kill he got. Because I saw Meteos get it, and I'm like, there's no way Kha'Zix is getting blue buff when Meteos is here. Is Fnatic going to try and push out this bottom tower? Looks like they might get it.
I have to say that maybe most of the reason that High decided to turn for that kill, because, you know, Basel's going down, and he wanted to avenge his comrade, but mainly it's to grab that blue buff.
He wants blue buff even more. It's just so delicious here. And you can see High a little behind in CS to Pekka. As we said, Fnatic's star players here really looking good in terms of individual skill in their lanes.
And now we do have an Elise gank down bottom, but also a Rumble gank in the mid.
Yep, Walls rotating down. Pekka taking a lot of damage here, and High trying to go in. The damage continuing on here. They're going to chase through yet another tower. Flash auto there for Walls. That's going to pick it up in overheat.
So I talked about how, you know, he's taking the cleanse for the Fiddlesticks ganks. Cleanse doesn't help you that much against a Rumble gank there. Good rotation for Balls, and they run into Soaz.
They're going to find him here. Equalizer popping down as well. Cyanide, though, is off to the side of Meteos. He's there. He's going to look for the Crowstorm. Over the top. Here he comes, High, trying to bait the back.
Oh,
Meteos over the top. Balls gets a kill. Kha'Zix gets a second as well.
And the main reason they won that 2-2 trade right there was the beautiful Rumble ultimate from Balls. He started it on Soaz and threw it backwards so that Cyanide had to come walk through it and was burning the whole time too.
And now Cloud9 in a three-man push towards the mid as well. And we're going to see this again, Kirby.
So the double wards, well played by both guys. And Soaz knows that he's beefy enough that he can stop their exit, but that Rumble ultimate, my goodness.
Oh, great hook! Orianna in there as well. The box being chucked down at Sneaky is forced to splash out very, very swiftly.
He's going to be real lucky to get away with his life just for his flash right there, because that was a beautiful death sentence shockwave combo from Fnatic.
Tower taken out towards the bottom lane as well for Fnatic, so they're going to pick up the first one of the game here. Meteos going to continue to farm things up now as well. And again, this game, a little tighter than the last one. Cloud9 only about 1,000 gold ahead with that tower being taken up by Fnatic, but they're playing in the same way here. It's exciting to see Cloud9 play this way.
You know what else is exciting? No, Balls back on his main champion and back to his main build here, just rushing the Liandry's Torment. It's a very offensive build, and it's something that he just always goes back to because he's so confident in his ability to place those Rumble ultis that it adds so much more damage. It's just an amazing way to start out a team fight. Whenever you have that percentage burn on most of the Fnatic team, it's going to mean that they will get an objective after.
And we've seen the damage that Balls has been able to do just in the skirmishes we've seen already, so it's pretty scary that he's got to Leandry's this quickly here at about 12 minutes, so we'll see how that plays out here. High actually rotating down towards the bottom, curiously enough. They kind of want to get mid-tower potentially here for Cloud9.
Yeah, the rotation of the double ADs, it's now time for them to take control of the jungle because they have now started getting the kills and they've got the gold lead. They'd like to take down the mid turret and then be able to start warding up the blue buff so that they can control both of those.
It might be to do with the fact as well that Reckless is just CSing so hard against Sneaky, but Sneaky's actually not that far behind in gold, interestingly enough. So kind of keeping even with objectives in there as well. But if they can get the mid tower, as you pointed out, Kobe, just such a central, strong objective to take early.
The Adoration Stacks really did a great job there getting him right back into this game. He needed to get that kill because if he was down a whole BF sword, then there would be no way that he could lane against Reckless.
Yeah, Meteos here down towards the bottom lane hanging out, but giving up on that gank just for now. Looks like he's building towards a Morellia Nomicon, perhaps, with the Phoenix Codex. He's got lots of choices here, but he wants cooldown reduction. That much I can tell you.
Could be that, or it could be, you know, going for a Deathfire Grass. Just kidding.
That would be sweet.
No, he's probably going to be looking for a Zhonya's Hourglass at some point, though, too, because he's not got a lot of defensive stats right now. You know, just the health from his one Doran Ring.
Calling back, actually, I think one of the Chinese teams playing a lot of Fiddle, actually, in their last event. I think Morellia Nomicon Banshee's Veil was the build there. So I'm wondering if Meteos
has seen that. No Zhonya's there, I guess.
No, I mean, it's just, it's a great item, obviously, if you can get it, but it's a little too expensive from the jungle. But with the way Meteos likes to play, if anyone's going to get the gold from the jungle, it's going to be him.
I feel like that may be a better route because, you know, not being able to move around with the Zhonya's does have its drawbacks. We'll have to see what he says.
We will. I mean, Meteos, again, kind of playing his new school. He's like, yeah, I have some other junglers, but here's a new one. It's Fiddlesticks. And it's fun to see here as Reckless continuing to farm up down the bottom. Have to say, when Hai's not roaming on him, he's looking a lot better.
He's looking better, but we already are seeing the roam here from C9 for the Dragon. They've got the timer down, 10 more seconds. They have a Liandry's Empowered Rumble. That is a mean. That means that you're winning this Dragon fight. Whatever's going to happen down there, you've got a huge amount of damage that's going to come down. So it'll be really hard for Fnatic to contest it. Looks like they actually sent him back up top lane, though, because they're so confident here. And it could turn into a 4-on-4.
Cyanide getting sneaky! Stales the Dragon! He's trying to ride the Lantern, but he's getting CC'd up so hard! Wow. Almost goes down in sneaky. Is he going to throw out the Draven ult? No, he doesn't want
to
do it.
So they send Balls back to the top lane because they're confident they can just take that one down. But Elise has the perfect kit for stealing away Dragons there. I mean, you can shout about smites all you want, but the abilities Elise's Q execute in spider form just gives her a huge upper hand that's really, really hard to outplay.
And you're right, Rumble's ultimate, kind of known for being the ult that wins dragon fights in that choke point, and they just didn't want to send me down, too concerned about Soez pushing in, but they will rotate now towards the mid and get a counter push here. Looks like the tower's going to go down, but Peke moving to defend, and never mind, Yellowstar here as well. Actually, Death End is landing onto Lemon Nation, but not quite. Follow-up, Kakuno's going to come in. There's the Orianna ultimate straight onto the box, and Cyanide will clean up that kill as Meteos. A little late on the Crow Storm Party. Oh, nice rappel out as well. Reckless, though, down the bottom. High going in for that kill, and he's going to pick up that one for himself. So a trade back and forth here. One in mid for Fnatic, one down the bottom for Cloud9.
And since Meteos is maxing his drain life first for the quicker damage and jungle clear there, his fear is still very low duration, so not able to keep anyone in place for the kill.
And Cloud9, despite all the early game aggression and movement...
Oh, he gets cocooned!
Yeah, he's getting cocooned up, played back in there as well, and Cyanide going to dive in there as Peke will pick up that kill. Now Fnatic continuing to work on this mid lane turret. High's going to get the bottom one, but I think Fnatic are going to go 2-1 up in turrets now.
Well, it looks like another rotation from Balls, or the threat of a rotation. Every time he starts heading down that river, he turns right back and goes up to check Soaz.
It's pretty scary. I mean, we already mentioned that quickly, Andrews. We've seen it here in Rumble himself doing a lot of damage early on, but Balls hasn't been in a fight yet with this early item, and I think we're going to go back to that Dragon, Kobe. It just feels like he should have been there.
Well, you know, it was an interesting call because even if Rumble was there, what exactly would he do to stop the Elise steal? I mean, he could have shot his ult over the wall to kill Elise after she did it, but it's very hard to stop her from grabbing it in the first place. So, you know, tactical decision there. Grab some minions instead, save some top turret damage. You know, could have gone either way. But what's really worth noting is that he's clawed his way back in CS to even with Soaz after being down early, since Renekton does have that early advantage. You know, once he gets his Liandry's, he plays so aggressively, and he was able to shove Soaz back off the minion line.
Yeah, I mean, Peke and Reckless still pretty far ahead of their laners as well. Reckless in particular, charging ahead in CS. He's 60 up or so now as well on this Lucian. So, I mean, his team talked him up. He was kind of needed to rise to the occasion here. His Death Tentus for Yellowstar just going to miss. Lemon Nation going to clear out some wards, but needs to be careful. Does get tagged by the cocoon, but he'll be okay. Oh, Meteos going in now as well. Yellowstar going to get Xenus bladed up. The damage coming in, but a great ult there from Peke actually to move over high. He's coming in. He's level 12. He wants the reset. He gets one. Can he go again high? Still going in. Activates his ultimate, but no. Forces a couple of flashes. Gets cocooned. And now he's going back in onto Peke. Gets the kill there. And beautiful teamwork from Cloud9.
High almost had too many targets to choose from in that fight. They didn't know which way to go. They grab two kills and they're going to shove right down the mid lane. They want to capitalize with the mid turret.
And they're going to do a lot of damage to this one as well. Probably able to take out the tier two. We saw Sneaky's Draven in game one. Really chunk down turrets. Kha'Zix as well. Just, it's gone.
Okay. I was wondering if Soaz was actually going to pull the trigger there. He was waiting around behind this Cloud9 team, see if he wanted to cut them off, but decides to pull back because they take down the turret so easily. And they do end up at giving that blue buff away in the end.
Yep, High's going to pick that one up for himself. Blue's up there on his side of the jungle for Meteor, so he'll be able to take that one away from himself. Looks like Spirit of the Spectral Wraith was the item he wanted to pick up, by the way. Oh,
the flash from Soaz wasted! The last 0.5 seconds of a recall. You're going to go back to base anyway. All right, so this is the three-man engage on four. They're able to get everybody low enough, and High comes flying in from the side, with the Q onto Reckless. Because of his previous duel down bottom with Reckless, he knew that he had the power at this point to take him down. And this is the time where Balls actually did roam, by the way. Came all the way down to mid, and that Rumble ultimately slowing down Peke just enough for High to jump on him and grab the second kill.
Yeah, and High's item build has really shot up pretty quickly here in this one. 4-0-3, but oops, Cyanide needs to be careful. I mean, Ravenous Hydro Last Whisper is no joke on the damage front.
Those are two core items nowadays for Kha'Zix. It's actually fairly comical that way in the beginning it was... Okay, never mind. Not story time now, it's killer time!
Soares is in trouble, pops his ultimate Dominus to try and get up, but Meteor's gonna chase him through with the Dark Wind. Ball's tanking up the tower now, so oh my goodness!
That was a tank too that they just melted right there. And it's the early penetration from both High and Balls that's allowing them to do this. Now they have the man advantage. Even though Sneaky's down bottom, this will just be a 4v4 at the turret. And High's got blue buff.
Yeah, Sneaky gonna try and push out the bottom as you mentioned. Fnatic rotating up here trying to defend. Sweeper actually popped in there. High's gonna find the one. He'll take it out instead. Meteos didn't like his chance of getting grabbed. Yellowstone, they're gonna come in. Lemon Nation over the top in there as well. High looking for the damage. If he gets some reset, he will get out there by limping. Meteos back in there with a Crowstorm. Now Peke in a whole lot of trouble as Reckless is trying to take out Lemon Nation, but he's a little safer now. Nowhere really left to run as Balls will tower up there to pick up that kill. Now up towards the top. Lemon continuing to juke back and forth. Does finally die.
Ball stays alive under the turret, but he's gotta keep on running here. There's three members on his tail, and one is Renekton. He's going to have a dash. Looks like he's got just enough distance to get away, though.
Yeah, Cyanide chucks the ward over Sneaky, by the way, soloing this dragon. That's a great call from Cloud9 to be like, hey, Sneaky, I know you're down the bottom lane. The dragon's coming up.
Yeah, hey, Sneaky, you've been kind of lazy pretty much most of the game here, grabbing those minions down bottom. Do some work for the rest of the team, please, and he gets the dragon.
He does indeed, well, with a little bit of help from
even gets the dragon.
Come on, Sneaky.
He tried.
He did.
He started it up. He softened it up for him. He got that one softened up.
I mean, there's no shortage of damage between these two ADs right now. Last Whisper finished up for Sneaky now as well. Look, I mean, just look at the AD damage between those two.
And it's really telling that they both rushed those Last Whispers too, because they're expecting some armor here early. Orianna, since she's laning against Kha'Zix, gonna start out with the Arm Guard, turn that eventually into a Zhonya's to stop resets, and then Renekton always, you know, pretty much always gets that Sunfire Cape, so they're gonna want to just destroy that front line.
And now another lead here for Cloud9 in this game. 3-3 in turrets are equal there. 11-6 in kills up for them as well, but you can see it's only about 2,600 gold or so between the two teams. And again, that's not a massive lead here at 22 minutes, but when Sina were in this position in game one, they found a way to just keep snowballing.
And even Sneaky, who's the pretty much the only member of Cloud9, you know, that hasn't been getting a whole bunch of gold from these kills and teamfights, even he has the build that he's comfortable with at this point in the game because, like I said before, Draven scales so well with just pure AD because of his spinning axes. Having the old Legolas build that was coined over in Europe with the Bloodthirster and Last Whisper provides him all that flat AD plus the penetration, so his spinning axes hit extremely hard.
Yeah, and looks like Meteos is actually going to go for probably a Zhonya's here as well, so need to see Lardra being picked up as well. I actually really like the Spectroith. I forgot that it got changed in this patch as well, because remember the game I would have watched with the Chinese teams playing Fiddle, that was on the old Season 3 patch.
Yeah, it's an interesting item that people are still not really sure which one they want to get. It's the more offensive of the jungles. It's between that and the Spirit of the Ancient Golem. You know, he lacks a little bit of extra life and tenacity, but he gains up a lot of sustain in the jungle.
And that's Yellowstar in trouble. High does the damage to Sneaky. He's able to clean it out. Now Stoas in a whole lot of trouble. Cyanide's going to get chucked massively there by Draven's axes, but Renekton nowhere to run. The double kill popping in for Draven as Peck is going to get chased down. That's a triple kill, actually, as Cyanide's going to go down as well. And Fnatic a little out of position trying to start a fight.
Yeah,
blown up.
I'd say he's okay with his build right now. That flat AD doing a lot of work right there. Sneaky now has the double buffs as well. And the only reason that wasn't a complete massacre was because, you know, High missed one reset right there while Cyanide was able to flash away. And they ended up killing him later anyway.
And popping up here. Went from about 2,500 gold to 5,500 gold. Inhibitor going to go down there as well. Oop! Minions!
Oh, it doesn't!
Minions! Oh! They do the work. Purple caster minion putting in the hard yards.
Almost able to clear them all out with the static shiv before it goes down, but not quite. This is a good pink ward bait? Question mark? Nah, too dangerous.
Nope, no. Do not fight high right now.
You don't want to. Oh, he's going to face check instead. That's actually a worse choice. High doesn't quite see him, and they're not going to. Neither one pulls the trigger. High's actually sticking around. Okay, let's go look at the replay first, though. High, he's going to go for Yellowstar once again. Every time Yellowstar pulls him in, he just bursts him down. Even though he jumped out of the fight, Yellowstar went down, so he got the reset. And Sirenite, there was the flash away that I was talking about that didn't give him the third reset, but since he has nowhere else to come down, he ends up dying anyway.
And a really nice Rumble ultimate as well for Ball to kind of tie it all together. And that's not a surprising thing for me to say here, given how much experience he has on Rumble. And Fnatic falling further and further behind in gold here in this game. It's close to 6,000 ahead for Cloud9 now as well.
I want to just say that it's so impressive Cloud9 have the confidence to continually run these losing lanes basically into this Fnatic team that keeps picking Renekton and Lucian and jungle bullies like Elise. And they have the confidence that they're going to be able to make up for it in the mid game with the rotations and grab the kills that they need to get the giant leads that they've been able to get to in back-to-back games.
And it's funny to me. You're right in that they are picking losing lanes, apart from bottom lane, which I think you're kind of forced into just picking a lane that can fight the other guy. And Sneaky did and still is very far behind Reckless in CS. But Cloud9 are almost saying, okay, we're going to lose early game, but we're level 6 lanes. Once we hit level 6, we can start making plays with our ultimates. And that's a lot of how this game won and this game is going now as well.
High down there with the blue buff. Looks like he does want to tango with Soaz.
Nope, Cyanide doesn't want to tangle with anyone here, especially Balls. The Zenith Blade going to land in there as well. Cyanide's just absolutely burning. He good lantern out though, and the Lemon Solar Flare will miss on Leona.
Little bit late there. So, like I was saying, the sustain that you gain from the Spirit of the Spectral Wraith as High finishes
Reckless
off the tango.
Reckless in a whole lot of trouble as well as Lemon Nation picks up credit for that. Now Yellowstar getting chased down and Cloud9. Two of them are busy doing Baron. High gets the double kill.
They're doing
kill.
Three things at once right now. Meteor soloing up the Baron.
Oh, and Sneaky Joy! Meteor's a beautiful zone, but I think he's in trouble. Gonna keep going, but Cyanide picks up that kill. High though!
Oh my!
Gets another kill. That's four kills in a row for Kha'Zix.
The other advantage of going with that giant flat AD build there for Sneaky is that his ulti hits like a truck, and High able to jump in here. He's got plenty of damage to finish him off. Wow, that was they were doing about four different things at once. So Baron is a very sticky spot to be stuck against Orianna. Beautiful shockwave by Peke there, setting this up. They almost grab both kills, but Sneaky gets away and then comes back with a giant ulti that's again timed with High's use of the Q execute and another giant bleeding red bar there.
Who needs a jungler to do Baron, Kobe? Not Cloud9, apparently. Meteos was trying. He was like, yeah, guys, I'm going to hang out with Sneaky and do it.
Yeah, so I was about to talk about the sustain that you get from the Spirit of the Spectral Wraith, which is, you know, the kind of the trade-off with the Ancient Golem there. You don't have the straight-up health, but you do gain health and mana back when you're doing damage to these jungle minions. So it does work on Baron, and he has plenty of AP that his Drain Life will sustain him there. Only problem is when you get caught by an Orianna in the back.
Yeah, and that's another dragon going off to Cloud9. 10-0-6 for Kha'Zix at this point. Absolutely monstrous game here for High. He was talking about it when we talked to him yesterday in the interview, there in the video as well. He really wants to show up here and kind of outplay one of the best European mid laners. And High has had two fantastic games at this point. Even if Cloud9 find a way to lose this game from this point, he still had some great games.
Yeah, I think he definitely deserved that praise from Bjergsen. He's really showed up. Both games here going a little deep this time, though.
High could be in trouble, though. You're right, a little deep. Kha'Zix trying to get out here, but so many members of Fnatic going to shut him down. Meteor actually in over the top. Here's Balls with the ult as well. Yellowstar going to get melted down, and that's a good zone. It's from Fiddle. Another kill comes through as Lemon Nation picks up Zellas. Now Cyanide in trouble as Balls are going to chase him down. Good flash there aggressively. Going to maybe pull his nose. Orianna saves him with Protect, and Reckless gets a whole chunk of gold from that one.
This again, though, it shows how Meteos has not hesitated to jump in with Crowstorms every time someone on his team gets caught. And they're able to turn around most of the time. This time, they actually only end up trading 3-2, so they're still down one kill. But that trust in your team, and it just really shows how Cloud9 have really come together. Even though High goes in on a suicide mission here, trying to pull out Reckless, and just gets cold to the face by Reckless. Nidos jumps in anyway, goes right through there, and then Balls doesn't hesitate, drops his ulti down right on top. There's so much burn right there that they're able to grab two kills from a losing situation anyway.
Yeah, and Balls, that was a smart flash from Cyanide actually towards the end.
Almost three, can't quite do it.
Almost there. Peke swoops in at the end with the command protect to make sure that his teammate lived. But Cloud9 still up a big chunk of gold there. It was 10,000 before, Kobe. It's now a little closer to 9. But Cloud9 are very, very happy with how this game is going from this point. Fnatic, if they can dig deep, and we've seen in this patch that a lot of teams are able to make more comebacks, it seems, like they were in the Season 3 patch. But I mean, Cloud9, even when things go a little awry and they don't quite execute the way they want to, as you said, they're still being decisive and working together as a team.
Yeah, they're still being decisive. That decisiveness did just decisively lose them 3 Baron buffs, though. So they've only got 2 left, and it'll make the siege a little bit harder. But they do already have the mid lane down, so the path to victory is pretty much clear.
I mean, this mid inhibitor is kind of open at this point. I don't know if Fnatic are interested
in fighting.
It's a bit
drafty in there.
Yes, it is. Oh, Peke gets caught by the ult. Clint is out, though. He's going to be happy to have that summoner spell this time.
All right. The Leona ultimate down. Oh my goodness!
The snipe off to the side there is Peke.
Is the drawback of not having that flat health. You're really squishy if you get caught out and don't have the time to react with your Zhonyas. He did end up getting it in the end, but not quick enough there.
So Fnatic find a nice little win there, picking up Meteos, and Peke is going to pick up a nice chunk of gold there as a result. I mean, he's doing damage all of a sudden.
That's the other thing when you are playing with the Fiddlesticks. Both teams are aware that the Fiddlesticks is always looking for that spot in Fog of War to get his Crowstorm off from, and Peke just catches him out right here. It's pretty much an easy fight. He's trying to clear out that ward. Both teams are knowing that the Fiddlesticks is trying to be off on the side to get a good Crowstorm, so if they can get to you first, you're still an extremely squishy champion. It's kind of like having a piece of artillery that can do a lot of damage if you leave it alone, but if you can find it and get up close, then you take him out real fast.
So Cloud9 going to try it one more time here in the mid lane. And I have to say, Reckless still very impressive on the CS. They're basically identical in item build, despite the massive gold difference between the two teams here at this point. And if it wasn't for Sneaky playing Draven, who gets those extra bonus gold from his passive, he actually might be even further behind at this point.
All right, they are going to start making the move onto the exposed inhibitor, though. And they're confident in their 5v5 teamfight. So it looks like Soaz actually, they are going to try and stop this one. The Shockwave, a beautiful start.
Good double Shockwave. They're culling in there as well. Meteor's going to dive in with the Crowstorm. That's Cyanide getting out of Sneaky. Does a bunch of damage there to Peke, who's forced to pick off to Cocoon.
So
he's going to land there high, working it on the inhibitor, and Soaz almost going down. But Cloud9, they get what they want.
All right, the Rumble ultimate is amazing for starting off fights. It's not that great of an execute ability because it doesn't even deal the impact damage anymore. It's damage over time. But good try there from Boz, not able to grab Soaz. They get the objective and are definitely going to want to retreat and heal up.
Yeah, I have to say though, I think Reckless is a big thing here for Fnatic in terms of their comeback potential. I mean, the gold is getting slimmer and slimmer between these two teams. Cloud9 were up 10, then 9, now it's a little closer to 8 at this point as well. And Infinity Edge is going to be done very quickly. You can see the gold difference there between the two ADs, about 300.
That's a really good point, actually, that he won his lane so hard, yet he hasn't really been able to translate that into anything for his team as far as a lot of extra map control or a lot of, you know, one fights in the mid game, because there's so many things he has to watch out for as an AD carry. The Fiddlesticks is extremely dangerous. We've already seen how high can just obliterate him. And then there's also always the threat of the Rumble zoning power. When he lays that ultimate down, you can't be stepping anywhere near it.
Yeah, I mean, Balls just does so much damage just from AoE that if you're an AD in that team fight, you don't want to be standing anywhere near that as well. So we'll see what Fnatic can get done here. Looks like a dragon might be going over to them, but that's an awkward trade with Baron coming up very shortly afterward.
Interesting thing, though, since Dragon has been buffed, when we do get closer to the point where the average level in the game is around level 15, it's worth almost as much gold as Baron. 1,300 compared to only 1,500 there for Baron. Baron does have that very sweet benefit of the purple buff, though.
It does, and that's a lot of effective gold that you can't really buy anywhere else. Ward's being put down here by Cloud9. This is an elaborate Baron bait, but there's a ward right there for Fnatic. Hasn't been swept yet. Sweeper's on cooldown as well. They are going to start it here, though.
They do have the Liandry, so it helps a lot with taking down Baron from... Oh, there goes Meteos!
Lemonation going in onto Peke. The damage moving in. That's Peke getting caught out. A good Rumble off being down there as well. Solar Fire on top as he comes out of stasis and high. Looking for the resets. Finds one. Ball's going down as well. Reckless obliterated by Karthik. There's another reset. A Cyanide's going to go down as well. Looking for one more. Here is Lemons over the top there on the yellow star. They leave him alone. They don't care.
I have to say, this is beautiful Kha'Zix play by high. And Meteos right there. I just want to shout out the beginning of that fight. He flashes over a cocoon to get in place for his fear and avoid the stun at the same time.
And Cloud9 looking to really push down as much as they can here. They're actually going for Nexus turrets, it looks like, at this point. They're going to tank up what they can. Meteos will start things off here. I mean, a ton of damage they can deal to turrets here.
20-second death timers, only a support alive. This is definitely the right call, even though they don't have minions around. They can take out one Nexus turret and look to end the game.
10 seconds left, Yellowstar very dead as Ball pick up that kill. Now Cloud9 maybe going to take it. They are indeed, they're going to get down the Nexus. 2-0 North America in the Battle of the Atlantic.
Congratulations to Cloud9. Not only do they bring it home for North America in the Battle of the Atlantic, but they also get revenge for their loss at Worlds.
Listen to that crowd. We are, of course, in the studio here, the new one in Los Angeles, and they are very happy to have their boys win here.
And like I said, there is so much respect between both of these teams. Yes, it's fun to talk up the rivalry and everything, but all of these guys have played against each other in a lot of scrims as well, and they do appreciate everything that each other puts into this game.
But an impressive comeback win there to get revenge here for Cloud9. And for me, it wasn't just that they won, it was winning in style.
It was pretty good style right there. I love the confidence again, like I said before, for them to run these champions at. You know, they're looking for the kills towards the mid game. High definitely came up huge in both of them. I think we're probably going to have to give the MVP over to High for that mid lane play.
I think so too. Just, I mean, incredible play across the board. That was our featured matchup for a reason. And High came out really big there in that one.
He definitely delivered. They've struck back at Fnatic, silenced some of the naysayers that were over in Europe, talking down to all of North America. And they're pretty happy with themselves.
And they should be. Cloud9, the winners of the Battle of the Atlantic here. That means North America picks up the title there as well, which I'm sure all you guys here are very happy about. Going back to that game, though, I have to say Reckless played actually incredibly. Just the rest of his team couldn't quite be there for him.
So he did really well in that lane phase, but you're right. It never came together for Fnatic in team fights, in mid-game rotations. They really fell behind very quickly. As soon as Cloud9 made the first move, they would just grab one little piece of advantage, and then they never lost their lead.
And that's kind of the biggest thing that Fnatic were talking about, saying it's not just that we've got a super good player, and he is super good. We're a team. We're a five-man team. We have to play together here. It's not just enough for Reckless to do well. And he did well, and all of Fnatic looked good there, but Cloud9 today, at least, just looked better.
I think that, you know, Cloud9 did a great job of getting Fnatic out of their comfort zone. They didn't have the classic Peke roaming late game with teleport. First game, we made him go on Renekton because we took Kassadin and they wanted to do some counterpicking stuff. Maybe a little bit unorthodox for this Fnatic team, not quite used to team fighting with Peke on Renekton. And then the second game, they have him on Orianna with a cleanse instead of a teleport or instead of a barrier, and it really didn't work out for them either.
Yeah, I mean, we saw a lot of fun stuff in there as well. Meteos' fiddle looking good there. I mean, all of Fnatic looked like they played fine. It's just, I guess they're still working out a couple of the kinks working towards, and both these teams are going to be very impressive to watch in their respective LCSs as well. So definitely looking forward to that.
His fiddle and his Vi, I think both of those deserve shout-outs. He got a ban on it the second game. Going with that DPS build. Going with DPS builds both times around, actually, because something in Season 3 Meteos was really known for was full tanks on pretty much everybody. But both games here, he's brought the damage, and he's made use of that damage.
And big credit as well to Lemonation's Leona. He just kept making plays. He was doing his best Crepo impression from Friday, I guess. Looking really good.